Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Paul Robinson, former United States Ambassador to Canada, welcoming you to Firing Line. This evening, we're at the Chicago campus of Northwestern University Law School, and we have a very great program in store for you. Now I'd like to take this occasion to introduce to you an outstanding Chicagoan, Bill Farley.
Hi, everyone. I'm Bill Farley, and we're delighted to be one of the sponsors here for this evening's great debate. There are some great debaters here this evening, and I think it's going to be a very important and timely show. We hope you'll enjoy it. Paul, shall we go in?
Thank you, Bill.
This is a production of SICA, in association with Producers Incorporated. This Firing Line special is made possible by a major grant from Farley Industries, building worldwide leadership for America. Additional support was provided by the Chicago Resource Center, Incorporated, and the Chicago Friends of Firing Line.
Good evening. From Northwestern University Law School in Chicago, welcome to a special edition of Firing Line, an all-star debate on the subject of the end of the Cold War, or as William F. Buckley Jr. has characteristically chosen to frame the issue, resolve that the Cold War is not coming to an end. This framework very cleverly allows Mr. Buckley and his fellow conservative naysayers to appear to be in the affirmative side of the issue, but it does sound a little bit like that old song, "Yes, We Have No Bananas." A couple of weeks ago, many people might have thought that this whole debate was unnecessary. Voices as diverse as Margaret Thatcher in Britain and the New York Times editorial page were saying that the Cold War was not only ending, but actually over. However, recent events in China, I think, have given pause to everyone who thought, or at least hoped, that the changes going on in the communist world were proving irreversible. So tonight's opportunity for reflection is especially timely. I'm Mike Kinsley, editor of The New Republic. My job here tonight is to assure a proper balance of heat and light, but with the cast of characters we have lined up, that shouldn't be much of a problem, and I'm sure there'll be plenty of both. So would you all please welcome tonight's debaters. Let me make some introductions here, which are mostly superfluous. Captain of the affirmative team is William F. Buckley, Jr., founder and editor of the National Review, founder and host of Firing Line, and a man without whom the Cold War would not have been possible. or at the very least, not as much fun. Congressman Newt Gingrich is House Minority Whip and founder of the Capitol Hill Jim Wright Literary Appreciation Society. He is known to his friends as the Robespierre of the Republican Party, and if you'd like to know what he's known to his enemies as, you can just send me a self-addressed stamped envelope. General Al Haig is former Supreme Commander of NATO, former Secretary of State, former White House Chief of Staff, and a former presidential candidate. He's also the author of many famous pithy phrases, but General, please remember, tonight I am in charge here in this debate. Richard Perle is one of America's leading neoconservative intellectuals. He was Assistant Secretary of Defense in the Reagan administration in charge of nuclear weapons, NATO, and miscellaneous mischief, if I can summarize a long resume. That resume also says he testified in front of Congress 80 times since 1981, but I think that's just a plea for sympathy, which I don't think he'll get. On the negative team, on the negative side, which is the side that says, no, we do have bananas, just to keep all this straight, the captain is former Senator and Democratic presidential nominee George McGovern, for a man for whom William F. Buckley might say the Cold War never even began. Former Senator Gary Hart was Senator McGovern's presidential campaign manager, and he was so successful there that he decided to run for himself twice in 1984 and 1988. It has been said of Senator Hart rather unkindly that in some ways he is his own Newt Gingrich. Congresswoman Pat Schroeder almost ran for president in 1988, but came to her senses in the nick of time. She is best known for her campaign to make our allies in NATO and Japan share more of the defense burden of the West, and that job will certainly become a lot easier if the Cold War is in fact over. Congressman Steve Solarz, Congressman Stephen Solarz is the only man on the left side of this table tonight who has never even publicly contemplated running for president. His well-known goal is to be Secretary of State. He is possibly, however, best known as the first American, or at least the first American politician, to liberate Imelda Marcos' shoe closet during the Philippine Revolution. And he is thus the patron saint of oppressed shoes throughout the world. So that's the lineup, and Mr. Buckley, I invite you to come to the podium and propose the resolution. You have 3 minutes. And this is the gavel.
My time hasn't started yet.
No.
ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Kinsley, our distinguished colleagues, our benighted friends, is life safer today in the Soviet Union for a dissenter than it was 5 years ago? Answer yes. Is life safer in China today than it was 1 year ago? Well, no. Is the Western geopolitical alliance better off today than it was 5 years ago? Well, no. The Western alliance appears to hang by the threat of a 7% third party in West Germany, which comes closer and closer to a position of dogmatic nuclear disarmament. Mr. Gorbachev's visit to West Germany documented that the West German public likes him and trusts him much more than they do the president of the country which brought West Germany back to life after Hitler and has preserved its sovereignty for 45 years, while its eastern sister suffered what might call life under Stalin's shadow. The West Germans give a favorable rating to Gorbachev of 92%, a favorable rating to President Bush of 52%, and a favorable rating to their own democratically elected leader of 43% only, Elvis Presley. And perhaps in the bad old days, Adolf Hitler would have scored higher than Gorbachev. Some people would call this the Stockholm syndrome. You remember when you fall in love with your kidnapper? And then almost without noticing, a few weeks ago, we saw the sudden death of the mutual animosity pact between the Soviet Union and the People's Republic of China. They are now a geopolitical entity, and it is anticipated that 107 Soviet divisions will no longer need to man the Sino-Soviet frontier. There are those of us who are not heartened by this act of bilateral fraternity. Meanwhile, we've got what from the Chinese? They very much desire, A, our money, B, the release to their executioners of the dissenter Fang Lizi, who lives in our embassy. There's about an acre there, the last enclave of freedom in China. Amazing what the coming end of the Cold War is doing for that part of the world. Granted, in the Soviet Union, you are today as safe denouncing totalitarian practices as well as the Chinese students were up until 2 weeks ago Sunday. And yes, Gorbachev has said that he will reduce the size of his army by 500,000 men, and he will retire 10,000 old tanks. But there is no commitment to reduce the production level of 3,500 new tanks per year. But I'll let General Haig explain to us the meaning of the Soviet military reduction in terms that shed meaning on the end of the Cold War. Make no mistake about it. I and my colleagues greatly welcome the extent to which economic reality and spiritual yuppiness and Stinger missiles have put pressure on the Soviet government. But this doesn't surprise us. Certainly didn't surprise Lenin in the 20s when he invited in the capitalists and got the first breath of Arnold Hammer, who will not take his final breath until every Soviet citizen has a Pepsi Cola, a McDonald's hamburger, and a Molotov cocktail. But can we persuade ourselves to believe that if Winston Churchill were here tonight, it was he, you will remember, who declared the Cold War, that he would say that this is, on existing evidence, coming to an end. Mr. Churchill did not deal indulgently with Neville Chamberlain when flying back to Munich. He brought Europe peace in our time. He would rather look into the face of Congressman Solarz and Schroeder and Senators Hart and McGovern and ask, are you quite mad? The answer to this question, I leave it to you and 93% of the West German people to wrestle for an appropriate answer to. Thank you.
Congressman Solarz, you have 3 minutes to oppose the resolution.
I can see, listening to Mr. Buckley's argument, that it's not just the conservatives in the like those such as Mr. Ligachev in the Soviet Union who are disoriented by Mr. Gorbachev's policies of perestroika and glasnost. There may be some who find Mr. Buckley's prognostications of gloom and doom persuasive, but I suspect that there are others, such as Mr. Buckley's political heroes like Margaret Thatcher, who has said the Cold War is already over, and Ronald Reagan, who was last seen kissing babies in Red Square, who would find them somewhat strange. The position which we are advancing this evening does not require us to go quite as far as Prime Minister Thatcher. We are not arguing that the Cold War has come to an end. We are contending that the Cold War is coming to an end. The evidence I would submit is clear and convincing. Consider, for example, some of the dramatic changes which have taken place in the last few years in Soviet domestic and foreign policy. Internally, they now have multi-candidate secret ballot elections. They have open and even divisive debates in their parliament. They've stopped jamming the foreign radios. They have a considerably freer press, and they have much greater freedom of emigration. In terms of their foreign policy, the Soviet Union has withdrawn its armed forces from Afghanistan. They've played a constructive role in facilitating an agreement in southern Africa, which has provided for the withdrawal of all Cuban troops from Angola. They're encouraging Vietnam to withdraw from Cambodia. In the INF Treaty, they agreed to the elimination of an entire classification of nuclear weapons, and for the first time since the dawn of the nuclear age, agreed to the principle and practice of on-site inspection. They've submitted a proposal in the conventional arms reduction talks, providing for parity between NATO and the Warsaw Pact in a way that would require the Soviet Union and its allies to withdraw and dismantle 10 times as many tanks, artillery pieces, and armored personnel carriers as we would be required to withdraw and dismantle. Now, this is not to suggest that the millennium has arrived. It hasn't. Nor is it to suggest that the Soviet Union is a political paradise. It isn't. Clearly, prudence must remain the order of the day when it comes to American foreign policy. So long as the Soviet Union has unacceptable military advantages, we need to remain strong. And any agreements between us must clearly be based on the principles of reciprocity and verifiability. But who, except our opponents, can realistically and responsibly deny that profound changes have taken place in Soviet policy which create for the first time an historic opportunity to establish an enduring peace between our two countries? Some, like Mr. Buckley, seem to fear these changes. I say we should welcome them and seize the opportunity to bring the Cold War to an end.
Thank you, Congressman. General Haig. General Haig, if you will please ascend to the podium and give us a concise minute and a half of your wisdom.
Well, I'm certainly delighted to have this opportunity to be an advocate for the resolution that the Cold War is not coming to an end. I'm also very pleased to have this distinguished audience today because it's the largest group I've been able to muster in over a year of campaigning for the presidency. Now, as much as we welcome Gorby and 4 years of remarkable change in the Soviet Union, indeed it would be premature, if not wrong-headed, to conclude that the Cold War has ended or has even largely ended. Now, what is the Cold War? The term was best described by the London Economist recently when it said it was non-lethal struggle for advantage between East and West and between Washington and Moscow. So the alternative of lethal struggle we have avoided, thanks to our clear-headedness and our strength and the struggle to preserve our values. Now, the dimensions of this competition between East and West are multifold. They involve the various conceptions in political theory between the so-called social compact, the relationship of the state to the individual. There's been no fundamental change in that. There are differences in arms control, which are now becoming politically focused by both sides, I may add, political, economic, and other differences. And in this debate today, we should focus on each of these segments, and we'll find that the Cold War is anything but concluded.
Thanks, General. Don't leave. Don't leave. Now you have an opportunity to question him from the left side, and please make sure your questions are in the form of a question, as they say on Jeopardy. No speeches. Ms. Schroeder, would you like to start, Senator McGovern?
I'd like to pose a question to you. Granted that the Cold War is not over at this point, wouldn't it be in the interest of both sides, both the Soviet Union and the United States, to enter into a series of verifiable mutual reductions on both strategic and conventional weapons? Mr. Gorbachev has even said he recognizes the problem of Soviet superiority on conventional weapons, and that they would make larger proportionate cuts there than we do. Isn't that one way, in fact, to seize on this historic opportunity to end the Cold War by reducing both the cost, this enormous cost, to both the Soviet Union and ourselves of an open-ended arms race, and at the same time reduce the danger of war?
Mm-hmm. Well, we have no differences there, Senator McGovern. Clearly, it would be to the advantage of East and West to have a reduced burden in the level of armament that we maintain. But in that process, we must be very, very careful that the advantages and the ultimate outcome is greater stability rather than less stability, such as, for example, denuclearization, which might make conventional war legitimate in Eastern Europe or Western Europe, would be the worst outcome. So there must be balanced reductions symmetrically accepted. I think George Bush's recent proposal, which would require a 10-to-1 reduction on the part of the Soviets and greater reductions, is going to put the burden on Mr. Gorbachev at long last. And I would suspect we're going to find less acceptance. The last day of his visit in Bonn, he took a crack at those proposals after he saw he had won a massive public relations victory in Bonn. So let's say the jury's still out.
Ms. Schroeder.
Yes. General Haig, I'm really pleased that you put the Cold War in its historic context, because I think, in a way, we should celebrate what's happening, because it's really what the NSC predicted. If you remember, in 1950, the National Security Council came out with Resolution 68, and a lot of the right-wingers didn't like it. But it was the definition of the containment policy, in which they said, look, the West should develop its moral and economic strength, contain the Soviet Union rather than try and roll it back, because the world was too tired and worn out in 1950, and that the Soviets would see then the falsity of their assumptions. And to me, I think that that document has guided us very well, and we are seeing the fruits of that as you look at Poland, as you look at a lot of the Eastern Bloc countries, and you look at the Soviet Union themselves trying to deal with the corruption and everything else.
What's the question?
Well, do you agree historically? I mean, you're saying, you know, that you're very concerned that the Cold War has been going on, but don't you think that we're right on course as to where we want to be? Isn't this our guidance, and shouldn't we be delighted?
Well, I noticed that Congressman Solarz referred to my colleague, Mr. Buckley, as that gloom and doom artist. As a matter of fact, rather than be pessimistic that the Cold War is not over, we shouldn't take that as a grim piece of news. We should accept it for what it is, and we should be celebrating the fact that we are enjoying today a considerable victory of the supremacy of Western values and the bankruptcy of Marxist-Leninism. This is all true, but the lethality of the Soviet system has not dissipated or disappeared simply because Mr. Gorbachev has no alternative but to impose these new changes brought about by his own failures and the failures of his own system. So we've got to keep our powder dry, we have to meet them halfway, but we have to have a degree of skepticism. For example, these arms control proposals are, in my view, more designed to split Europe from the United States and West Germany from Europe than they are to achieve arms reduction.
Very quick question, Congressman, designed to elicit a quick answer as well.
Al, when you were Secretary of State several years ago, if someone had told you that by the end of the 1980s, the Soviet Union would have withdrawn all of its forces from Afghanistan, would have supported the departure of Cuban troops from Angola, would have proposed a conventional arms reduction agreement establishing genuine conventional military parity in Europe, and that there would have been debates in the Soviet parliament in which the KGB itself was being denounced. Mm-hmm. Under those circumstances, would you have dismissed these developments as irrelevant, or would you not, in fact, have seen them as evidence that Cold War tensions between the United States and the Soviet Union were declining?
Well, I have
Yes or no, we'll do on that one.
Yeah. Let me just say, Steve, in 1974, I remember the first speech I gave to the North Atlantic Council. And during that speech, I said, the Soviet system is unraveling, and that we have the greatest opportunities in post-World War II history to insist on rule of law and peaceful change rather than a continuation of bloodshed, terrorism, and so-called wars of liberation. Now, it was very evident to me in the mid-70s that this process was underway, and it will continue if we continue to stay strong, unified, and coherent in our policies.
Thank you, General. Thank you. Senator Hart. You're off the hook. You're off the hook. Be seated. Senator Hart, you have a minute and a half.
On behalf of myself and the members of our team, I'd like to say thank you to Mr. Buckley for his invitation to be here again this evening. The eminent diplomat and scholar George Kennan recently said that the time has finally come after 40 or 45 years to begin to consider the Soviet Union as something other than our principal military opponent. That, I think, is an excellent definition of what the Cold War was and why it indeed is coming to an end. We're not here tonight to debate whether the Soviet Union has become democratic. By our definition, clearly, it has not. Even though some of the steps that have been taken, members of our opposition in this debate would have said and have said would never occur in the Soviet Union. This debate is not about China, because with the possible exception of my friend Mr. Buckley, very few Americans still believe China is going to attack the United States. The debate is not about whether the Soviet system will approximate our system, because clearly it will not. The debate is about whether today and tomorrow the Soviet Union, as Ambassador Kennan says, represents principally a military threat to us or our military opponent. Indeed, it does not. It is not the end of the beginning, but it is the beginning of the end. And what we are seeing today and will see in the days to come is, I hope, a competition for peace.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Don't leave, though. Does anyone on that side have a question for Senator Hart?
Mr. Perle. Senator, about a year ago, a little more than a year ago, in commenting on Mr. Gorbachev's Soviet Union, you said, and I quote, there aren't enough rubles to put space weapons up and continue on a mindless nuclear arms race and modernize his own society. In that respect, he's ahead of our own leadership. In the intervening year since that remark was made, we can find no evidence of any reduction in either the Soviet space weapons research and development program or their nuclear and weapons programs generally. What's happened?
Well, I think what's happened is exactly what is happening on this side, that neither side is going to unilaterally disarm, with some exceptions, until there are some verifiable arms control agreements between the two superpowers. Mr. Gorbachev has offered those, and we indeed, I think, as of today, are starting once again to negotiate those arms control agreements. I wouldn't expect, and I don't think you would expect, the Soviets to unilaterally disarm while we continue to develop two strategic missiles as well as an entire range of strategic systems. On the other hand, I was recently in Czechoslovakia, where, in fact, Soviet troops and modern Soviet equipment and short-range missiles are being put on trains and pulled out absent a conventional force reduction agreement. All I'm saying is today what I said then, and that is that Mr. Gorbachev, I think, is the first of the two, of the leaders of the two superpowers to realize that you can't have a modern industrial nation and continue a mindless arms race.
Mr. Buckley, do you have a question? Congressman Gingrich.
Let me just follow up for a second, because I always find it fascinating that there's a mindless arms race which we and the Soviets are equally guilty of perpetuating. We recently had the opportunity to hear Madam Bhutto, the Prime Minister of Pakistan, talk to a joint session. She said the greatest shock she has had as leader of Pakistan is that the Soviets are clearly violating the agreement in Afghanistan, that they are mounting what she described as an airlift far larger than the Berlin airlift, and that it is militarily building up their puppet regime in Afghanistan to a degree no one anticipated 6 months ago. Now, I'm curious, Senator Hart, from your perspective, why would the bureaucracy under Mr. Gorbachev be so systematically disobeying his peaceful intent? Today, while we're having this debate, Soviet aircraft are lifting material into Kabul, into Afghanistan right now. Now, why would they be doing that if Gorbachev truly believes that his competition with the West is over?
Well, first of all, I didn't say he believed that, and I don't think he does. I think the competition will continue. The question is, will it continue militarily or in a variety of political and economic arenas? The fact of the matter is, at least the last information I had, we were also shipping arms into Afghanistan. So I don't think that's a one-way street. That has nothing to do with whether a nuclear arms race between us and the Soviets is mindless. I think most Americans believe that building a B-1 bomber that has trouble flying and whose costs escalate is a questionable investment. I think they're beginning to have some of the same questions about the stealth bomber. And I think there are a variety of other weapon systems that they could equally question as to what they contribute to our security or that of our allies. And I think Mr. Gorbachev is reaching a lot of the same conclusions.
Senator, wouldn't you call what you've just been describing something rather like a Cold War?
What I've been... No, what I've been describing is a train that is going down the track of 75 to 90 miles an hour that the engineer hasn't been told to slow down yet. I'm hopeful now that President Bush has seemed to have gotten some religion in Europe, and principally from our allies, I think, that he will begin to send those signals out. The fact of the matter is that this country, I think many of us feel, is racing towards bankruptcy. These $150 and $200 billion annual deficits aren't doing us any good either.
Let me just follow up on that. Doesn't... if I might, doesn't it disturb you just a little bit that Mr. Gorbachev says that he wants to back down on some of this competition, but in fact Soviet aircraft are landing in Afghanistan with military equipment, that he says he wants to back off in Central America, but in fact not only are weapons going to Nicaragua, but they're showing up in El Salvador. I mean, at what point do we measure the actual behavior of the Soviet Union as opposed to the latest press conference?
Oh, I think you measure it by a unilateral withdrawal from Afghanistan for whatever reasons. They have done that. Many people in this country said that would never happen. I think you measured by his speech in Cuba, in which he took that opportunity to inform not only Fidel Castro but the rest of the world that wars of national liberation are no longer the foreign policy of the Soviet Union, or at least under him. I think you measure it by steps he's taken in Angola and a variety of other places. If you don't believe that foreign policy under Gorbachev has changed, then you and I are not reading the same reports.
Thank you, Senator.
My
Thank
pleasure.
You very much.
Thank you.
George McGovern and Newt Gingrich, come on down. It's your turn, sir. Mr. Gingrich, you have a minute and a half to make an opening statement.
Well, I think I want to pick up exactly where we just left off, because we're not reading the same reports.
I think that Gorbachev is clearly involved in an enormous gamble domestically, and I think that it's a remarkable thing to watch and is in many ways comparable to watching the French Revolution in 1789 from Britain. However, I also think that the capacity of the Soviet Union to threaten the United States and to threaten the rest of the world is basically undiminished. And I think you've got to read both sets of reports at the same time. For example, if we had a newsreel tonight that showed the scale of the Soviet airlift and Madame Buteau's request saying explicitly to the United States Congress that it is a clear violation of the agreement, if we had a newsreel tonight showing the Soviet equipment in El Salvador, in Nicaragua, the reports that since Gorbachev visited Castro, they are talking seriously about sending Soviet equipment to Panama. If we had a report tonight on the poison gas that was used to kill demonstrators in Georgia and the Soviet Union, as a Georgian from the United States, I always make clear that distinction. One of the suggestions I would make is that, in fact, we may well be dealing with Alexander II, who, under great pressure from his defense minister, Milyutin, decided that he had to modernize the Russian state. He freed the serfs. He tried in a significant number of ways to modernize. But I would simply warn that the Russian system of centralized police state power has been unraveling for 250 years, that the West, every few years, sees a new hope, a new opportunity, a new love affair with the latest dictator. And then 5 or 10 or 15 years later, the Soviet police, prior to them, the Tsarist police, come back, and we see whatever the most recent spring has been ceased to thaw and winter returns.
Thank you. Senator McGovern? No, you're asking questions here. You're asking questions here.
Congressman Gingrich, granted that the Soviet threat is still there, I'm at a loss to understand that why that means we shouldn't do what we can to end the Cold War. Let me put it to you this way. Do you, as a member of the Congress, an American citizen, would you really like to see the Cold War end?
I would very much like to see the Cold War end on terms which are compatible with freedom and American security. But I would very much not like to see the Cold War end on terms which are incompatible with freedom and American security. And there's a big difference when you talk just about, do you want to see the Cold War end? I think on what terms?
Well, I agree with what Senator Hart said earlier. We're not going to transform Soviet society into a model of American democracy. But I also think that Mr. Gorbachev makes an interesting point that we do have differing systems, we do have differences, but we have certain things in common. One is an interest in survival. Another is the interest in getting out from under the economic burden of an arms race that may be weakening the influence of both of the superpowers in world affairs. What policies do you think the United States could follow that would best encourage a breaking up of the Cold War?
Well, let me say, first of all, I think standing in Chicago, I'm always a little deferential in talking about models of American democracy. But in that setting, I would nonetheless say that what I see happening domestically in the Soviet Union is fascinating. It's remarkable. But I think you've put your finger on the key question for the whole evening. No one on either side would disagree that fascinating, powerful things are happening. Where we would disagree, I think, is that on our side of this debate, we believe Americans have to focus on real behavior and measurable change and verifiable results, and we have to ensure that if the Cold War does end, it ends on terms that are compatible with Western freedom. And I would suggest to you that what has worked, and this is very hard, I think, for anyone on your side to concede, but what has worked in the last 8 years, frankly, are the fundamental policies of Ronald Reagan, that military strength has worked, that being daring in places like Grenada has worked, that the bipartisan effort to, and I know that sounds funny in this room to some people, but at the time it was very daring until it worked. Remember how weak we had. Let me simply suggest that the concept, that the sentence, Jimmy Carter sent troops to Grenada, is not printable in English. And let me go one step further. The fact was that Reaganomics worked to give us the longest expansion in peacetime history, to create the most jobs of any country in the modern world in the last 10 years. And the result is the Soviet Union, as Congresswoman Schroeder pointed out, the Soviet Union is truly contained, as it had not been for the preceding decade, and therefore is, in fact, I think, under enormous stress because the policies of the West are succeeding. And so I would argue we ought to basically continue the same policies of strength and containment until, in fact, we've won the Cold War on our terms.
Thank you, Congressman. Senator McGovern, you have a minute and a half. Senator McGovern, you have a minute and a half to make an opening remark.
Let me just say I'm delighted to be at Northwestern tonight. This is my alma mater. Some people think it's as good as Yale, Mr. Buckley. During my last year here, 1949, Northwestern won both the Big Ten and the Rose Bowl game. Haven't won much since then, but they've always turned out the sharpest thinkers in the country. Let me just come quickly. I think that the Cold War is ending, both in the Soviet Union and in the United States, because it no longer squares with the realities of the international situation. By 3-to-1 margins, the American people are telling pollsters that they think the economic health of this nation and of other nations has more to do with the influence and power of that country in the world than the size of their weapon stockpile. I think that's true. This is what Gorbachev has said over and over again, and what increasing numbers of Americans are coming to see. Gorbachev, as I read it, is not a Thomas Jefferson, but he's a hard-headed realist who recognizes that if the Soviet Union is going to address its serious economic and social and political problems, it must end the arms race and the Cold War. If the Cold War is coming to an end, we can encourage that process, not by the kind of unyielding and hardline policies that Mr. Gingrich has just referred to, but by joining in this effort for careful, mutual, verifiable reduction of the arms race.
Thank you, Senator. Mr. Gingrich.
Well, I'm fascinated by, I guess, two points. First of all, at the turn of the century, Tsarist Russia under Nicholas II had the same problem. They discovered that they were too poor to keep up with the Germans in particular, and they decided they were for disarmament. In fact, the first disarmament talks were brought about precisely because of Tsarist Russian poverty.
Don't forget the Jeopardy rule. There's got to be a question here.
There's going to be one. Since we didn't have Vanna White, I thought we could go slower and take a little more time. Although you have done a brilliant job so far of keeping us all in speed. My question is this, and I want to go to the very heart of what you started your statement with, the part after Northwestern, because I share your admiration. If economic health is more important than military power under your model, how do you explain the relative influence of North Vietnam, Libya, Syria, and the Soviet Union, none of which have been economically healthy in my lifetime, all of which are disproportionately powerful?
Well, I think for one thing, they've been following, as other countries do, the force of nationalism, which we never really seemed to understand in Vietnam. We thought by just sheer military superiority, and I think you would agree, Congressman, that that war wasn't resolved on military power alone. We clearly had superiority in the air, on the ground, at sea, and every other way. You've cited an example of where factors that other than the military determined the outcome of a struggle. And I think the same thing is true with regard to the situation in the world as a whole. No one here is calling for the United States to unilaterally disarm. What we're saying is that for 40 years, we've been trying to persuade the Soviet Union to take the kind of reasonable and accommodating moves they're now taking. I think it goes beyond what any one of us could have expected 5 or 10 years ago, that you have a Soviet leader in the position that Mr. Gorbachev is. And if what he is demonstrating, I think, all over the world, is the fact that military power is not the end of influence in the world. Used discreetly, of course, it's important.
But here we have an opportunity now to free the world from these two huge military blocks in an open-ended arms race and get the two of them looking for the areas of mutual interest, one of which is ending this arms race, another is survival, another is building up their own societies.
Let me just comment. First of all, when I referred to military power with North Vietnam, I was thinking of their invasion of Laos and Cambodia. When I was thinking of Syria, I was thinking of their invasion of Lebanon. And when I was talking about the USSR, it is by definition a non-national state. I mean, no one in Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, the Ukraine, you run out of time before you can name all of them, would think of the USSR as a national state. So I want to come back, because I think it's the core difference in our two groups. We all believe that military power, when held by a dictatorship, is a real threat, even if the current dictator has a good press secretary. We all think that we ought to...
Granted that Soviet military power is a potential threat to the United States, is it less of a threat if we enter into a series of agreements with them to reduce Soviet power, to bring about major cuts in both conventional and strategic forces? Why does that enhance the danger of Soviet power, the threat that you talk about? It seems to me that if we refuse to take advantage of this historic opportunity to end the Cold War, we not only bring down Mr. Gorbachev, but we open up the way for an even more dangerous Soviet threat.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Congressman. Mr. Perle. You have a minute and a half, Mr. Perle, to make an opening statement.
Ladies and gentlemen, one can argue the proposition that the Cold War is not coming to an end, while accepting that there are changes, including some positive changes, in the Soviet Union. One can hold both views because the changes in Soviet policy that we now see can be explained simply in terms of the failure of the Soviet system. A revolution that three quarters of a century ago marched under the banner bread and freedom has failed to deliver either. Life expectancy in the Soviet Union is actually declining. Prime Minister Ryzhkov said the other day that the Soviets this year would need to borrow $14 billion simply to finance their external hard currency debt. What we see in the Soviet Union today is a desperate effort by Mr. Gorbachev to reform a failing economy that is bringing down with it the communist system. Now, we don't have to include charitable descriptions of Soviet behavior, as the opposition has chosen to do this evening. The Soviets left Afghanistan after a decade, not because we persuaded them it was not in their interest, but because Stinger missiles were shooting down Soviet aircraft. The Soviet Union signed a treaty eliminating intermediate nuclear missiles, not because we were so persuasive, but because we deployed missiles of our own, and because we beat them at the negotiating table. Now, this is not the first time that we have seen a liberalization internally in the Soviet Union. In 1921, under the new economic plan, we saw a situation evolving very much like the situation today. And undoubtedly, there would have been a panel prepared in 1921 to say that the Soviet Union had been transformed. And they would have been wrong, as the panel today opposite is again wrong.
Thank you. Senator Hart.
Richard, since you left the Reagan administration, you have written a number of articles in which the scenario always seems to be the same, and that is that a hawkish, tough, properly anti-communist president is always being hoodwinked by his own accommodating pro-arms control staff or advisors, usually in the suggested to be insidious State Department. How does this happen?
Well, I think there is a prevailing view within the diplomatic service that the kinds of issues that have separated the United States and the Soviet Union can be settled at the negotiating table on the basis of reason and persuasion. My own view is that the Soviets are a good deal more responsive to power. And on those occasions when we've been successful in negotiating with them, it has been because our words have been backed up by strength.
Well, but you've also suggested in some of your writings that in the INF treaty and some specific provisions of that and other provisions of proposed arms control agreements that somebody inside the administration, and I think once or twice you refer to the State Department, is really undermining our will to prevail here militarily. I just was interested in knowing who those people were and how they get in the Bush and Reagan administrations.
Well, first of all, neither President Reagan nor President Bush has a great deal to say about the composition of the Foreign Service. There's a romanticism among the diplomats, Senator, that exists not only in the United States, but among diplomats around the world. And if diplomats around the world were in a position to make decisions, we might indeed have a more peaceful world. But unfortunately, it's the political masters who write their instructions. And the political masters in this case, in the Kremlin, go on building weapons as though there were no change. As a matter of fact, Senator Hart, since Mr. Gorbachev came to power in 1985, the Soviet Union has added to its military forces more tanks and more artillery tubes than exist today in the armies of Great Britain, France, and the Federal Republic of Germany.
Mr. Solarz.
Richard, you are noted for your opposition to the arms control process, and you have, I think, opposed virtually every arms control agreement which we've reached with the Soviet Union, arguing that these agreements tend to leave us more exposed to the Soviet threat than we would have been if we hadn't entered into the agreement in the first place. We now may be on the verge of getting a conventional arms reduction agreement with the Soviet Union in Europe. And if, as a result of that agreement, the Soviets were to fulfill their pledge to destroy 22,000 main battle tanks, can we expect to hear from you next that there is a dangerous and destabilizing buildup in the Soviet scrap metal industry, which we need to be concerned about?
Well, I'd like to answer the question, but the question contains a false premise, which I think I should be permitted to comment on. My criticism of the arms control process has been its failure to produce the kinds of results that I think you and I would both desire. The treaty banning intermediate-range missiles was a splendid example, in my view, of the right way to conduct the arms control process. Treaties that the Soviets have violated, like SALT I and SALT II and the ABM treaty, seem to me the wrong way to go about the process. But the answer to your question is it would make a great deal of difference which 20,000 tanks the Soviets destroyed. If they destroy 20,000 T-54s and T-55s of roughly World War II vintage, while continuing to produce 3,500 brand new tanks a year, they could wind up with a more formidable force even after enriching the Soviet scrap metal industry, and that would not be the end of the Cold War.
Senator McGovern.
Mr. Perle, all of us here are concerned about American security. I find myself these days worrying more and more about our security from the standpoint of a terrible drug problem that seized this country, the environmental crisis that jeopardizes the whole planet, the enormous deficits that we've rolled up in recent years, a $2 trillion national debt. And I have an increasing feeling that those problems may be a greater danger to us than the likelihood of a Soviet invasion. How do you see this as a security expert?
Well, I think the likelihood of a Soviet invasion is quite small. I think it's quite small in part because we are strong enough to resist such an invasion. If the day should ever come when we are not capable of resisting an invasion, then I think the danger of such an event would be increased immeasurably. But surely we have the resources both to deal with the problem of drugs and to maintain a reasonable level of defense. We presently spend...
Where do you get the money?
Well, we presently spend 6% of our gross national product on defense. So I would turn to the other 94% before I would diminish further the defense budget, which is already lower than President Carter's projections.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Perle. Thank you very much. Congresswoman Pat Schroeder.
Let me use my time to talk about what I think some of the shortcomings in being too myopic about the Cold War has been. During the Reagan administration, I was involved in lots of debates about whether or not the Reagan administration should allow sales of weapons to China. My side was no, that we did not know how stable China was and how strong the roots had gone after the very painful Cultural Revolution. Obviously, I lost. I lost to the other side who said, no, we must send weapons to China because it will make the Soviet Union anxious. I think that's driven much too much of what we've done in many of these aspects. It's been stand by our strongman, whether it's been Marcos or the Shah, Noriega. In many instances, we have been out there so bent on making the Soviet Union anxious that we have not thought about the long-term policies of it, as we saw this week and the last couple weeks in China. I think that we see all sorts of other problems, too, that we may have neglected a bit, whether it was the trade issue. There's been trade wars, drug wars, all sorts of wars, and environmental problems. I think that we must have a much more balanced overview, and we must be asking our allies to do much more. It made our sense what we did it all in 1945. Today, they are strong. They are viable. Yes, there are military threats. There are other threats, too. There's the threat of the debt and many other things. And we should be getting them on board, and we should be doing a much broader perspective as we prepare for that.
Thank you, Congresswoman. Does anyone have a question? Mr. Buckley.
Mrs. Schroeder, it seems to me that the burden of the argument that you are attempting, along with your colleagues, is to project welcome events of the past year or two on into the future and to assume that these are going to carry us into the end of the Cold War. What is it that we did to make the Soviet Union anxious on the eve of their production last April the 8th of the new decrees?
What I was saying, my philosophy is you don't stand by a Marcos too long, you don't stand by strong men too long, and you don't say the Chinese are our communists.
What did that have to do with the April 8th decrees, which imposed fresh penalties, more severe even than those exercised by Stalin, on any attempt to alter in any way contradicting the USSR constitution, or in the mass duplication or the use of technical equipment, arguing for an illegal alteration of the Soviet system, or for leading and guiding, failing to lead and guide, failing to acknowledge the Communist Party as the leading and guiding force of Soviet society. It seems to me that these were spectacularly unnoticed by those romanticists to which Mr. Perle referred.
But Mr. Buckley, I mean, you've also got to look at the phenomenal results that's happened in Poland just this week with the incredible elections. You've got to look at the fallout of the elections in the Soviet Union, where Gorbachev was forced to pull the plug on his own TV cameras that he wanted to have.
Mr. Schroeder, I'm going to question you, if I may.
Sure.
We're talking about the reversibility of present trends. We were sharply reminded 2 weeks ago that it is highly possible, for instance, in China. And I'm asking the question, what assurance do we have that it can't be reversed in the Soviet Union? And haven't we just seen the scaffolding, the constitutional scaffolding, to the extent that it becomes relevant in the Soviet Union, for exactly such a reversal?
Well, first of all, I never would ever believe that the Soviets are honoring constitutional law. So while you may be worried about that, I don't see that as one of the big things.
Why'd they do it?
Why did they do it?
Why did they
pass this
decree of
April 8th? Because they never pay attention to it anyway.
What?
They don't pay attention to it anyway. I mean,
when
did
you
think
Gorbachev signed it? Gorbachev signed it.
How many constitutional lawyers do you think there are in the Soviet Union, and what kind of Bill of Rights do you think that they have, and why would we even be concerned about that? I mean, I don't get... What I am saying is...
According to this decree, a constitutional lawyer would go to jail for 3 to 10 years.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. General Haig.
Yes. Sure.
I'm puzzled that you may be delivering a double standard here. You, on the one hand, you condemn an administration for hanging on too long to a Marcos and for not standing up for the values which we espouse. And on the other, you accept the premise that a Soviet system, which does not permit pluralism, which represses political choice and political freedom, and you've become an advocate for turning the other cheek on these abuses, but you are issuing a double standard with respect to those with whom we've dealt for many, many years.
Not at all. I am going back to the National Security Council number 68 that I started with, which said we should, you know, really develop the ethical and moral standards and economic standards of the free world. We agree on that. Secondly, we know that the Soviet Union is not a democracy. Everyone on our sides conceded that. They're a long way from being a democracy. But we also see this window open. It's an opportunity for exchanges, which I think you'd hope we'd have as many as possible, all sorts of exposure back and forth. And the positive thing that we just saw in China is the media has totally opened up this world. I mean, you look at the Cultural Revolution, there were no cameras there. They couldn't pull it off this time. Deng Xiaoping doesn't get it. But you just put in some satellite dishes around this country or fax machines or anything, and it's out. And that's probably done more for democracy than a lot of other things that have happened. But I think the same thing would happen in the Soviet Union today. Yeah. There's no more iron curtain because
I hope what you're saying is that we must hold the Soviet Union to the same standards that you're insisting we must hold our friends to.
Absolutely, but we can't hold them to that if we don't hold our friends.
A real quick one.
You see my point? If you don't hold them, you can't hold the friends.
I guess I'm puzzled by two things. First of all, if you go back to NSC 68, that containment included help to a wide range of governments under both Harry Truman and John F. Kennedy who would not meet your standard today. And they both argued vigorously for defending countries because to contain the Soviets you had to do that. But let me go back to your key question statement. You said a minute ago, quote, "I would never believe the Soviets would honor constitutional language." Now, how can you suggest we can in any significant way lower our guard with a regime you just described as fundamentally, permanently untrustworthy?
Really quickly.
Well, because their constitutional standards go vis-a-vis their citizens, and I find that appalling. Those are human rights violations, and I am the first. I don't think every time I've gone to the Soviet Union, I've been thrown out. I am not their kind of person, and I'd be in jail in 5 minutes if I were over there. However, what we're looking at is the superpower context of whether or not we can live on the planet without war. We have different interests, but certainly we have the same stake in peace. And that's what we should be working for, and we should also be trying to bring human rights to the Soviet Union, but we can't do it if we wink at some of our allies because they're non-communist but violate human rights.
Thank you, Congresswoman. Mr. Buckley. Anyone on that side have a penetrating question? Senator Hart.
Mr. Buckley, I take it from things that you have said, as well as your team here this evening, that your definition of the Cold War is that it will continue so long as the Soviet Union does not match our standards of democracy. Is that correct?
No, it's not my definition.
Well, we are debating.
I use Gene Kirkpatrick's definition. He said the Cold War developed in Europe in response to the use of Soviet troops to deny self-determination to the people of Eastern Europe. It will be over when the Soviet government renounces the use of force to impose governments and foreign policies of its own choosing on other states.
Then why is so much of the debate this evening given to whether or not the Soviet Union matches our standards of democracy?
Because we need very much to question whether we ought to rely strategically on the apparent Pollyanna attitude towards occasional blurts of free speech. There are too many people who feel that we ought to retire the Cold War to celebrate the fact that Yeltsin got elected to the Congress as a dissenter. It becomes the business of people who formulate foreign policy to ask the question, what about the reversibility of a doctrine and what does it imply in terms of our survival?
Senator McGovern, do you
have Bill, in your opening comment, you made a statement that we really don't have any assurance that the Gorbachev system won't be reversed. In other words, that we'll have a repetition of what's taken place in China. Let's assume that that may happen. somewhere down the road, 1 year, 5 year, 10 years. I'm not sure what your timetable is. But wouldn't we be better off in the meanwhile to negotiate a series of mutual reductions on both sides to get these huge nuclear arsenals reduced? If we can get Bush's proposal accepted in the Soviet Union, and Gorbachev said in Bonn last week that he was looking at it, wouldn't we be better off to make those reductions?
Not necessarily. We're better off as long as we can be confident that we can deter the Soviet Union. The marginal weapon is of zero interest to me. If they were to destroy 95% of their weapons, they could still present an apocalyptic threat. I'm interested only in the marginal withdrawal of that incremental nuclear bomb that threatens the sovereignty of the American people and that of Europe. So all of this, all of these treaties that infatuate you so, are of very little intrinsic meaning. What matters is what is their strength and what is our strength.
Yeah. Nobody on either side is talking about unilateral disarmament. We're not talking about reducing the relative power.
That's not true. George Kennan does all the time.
Well, he's not on the panel.
Oh, you want to disavow him?
No, I don't disavow him. I suppose he probably had more to do with the Cold War than either you or I. But in any event...
Yeah, that was back when he was sober.
Let me ask this, since we're all interested in doing what we can to reduce the danger of war. Do you think that it's really in our interest to take a position that makes it more difficult for Gorbachev to survive politically?
No, I don't. But it seems to me that we can't control the internal politics of the Soviet Union, and under the circumstances, we must limit our appetite to seeing to it that whatever happens to the Soviet Union, we are guarded against the kind of euphoria that makes Gorbachev the most popular German since Bismarck.
You know, the same kind of hardline hawks that you represent in the United States are in the Soviet Union. They're making it very difficult on Gorbachev, and he's got to show something, does he not, for these series of proposals and moves that he has made. It seems to me,
he's showing that there's a soft element in the United States and a pacifist element overwhelming West Germany. These are the fruits of his policy, plus $11 billion the West Germans have lent him just in the last 14 months. So he is, to the extent that he can, bringing home a certain amount of bacon. He's demoralized much of the concerted appetite of the United States to continue to remind him that he ought not to wander in dangerous waters. He didn't give up Afghanistan, as my friend Mr. Solarz says. We beat him in Afghanistan. In 1985, when he came to power in 1985, what did he do? The very first thing, he sent General Ormolov down there and intensified the rate at which civilians were killed. More people were killed in 85, 86, 87 than in all the preceding 7 years under Gorbachev. And then what happened? We set in our Stinger missile. He couldn't take it. We beat him there, and we are beating him economically in Southeast Asia. The entire effort of the Vietnamese has been financed by the Soviet Union. They're spending $8 million a day in Cuba and $1 million a day in El Salvador, while we coo here in gratitude over these occasional Roman candles that are lit.
Congresswoman Schroeder.
Well, I think we all agree that it's kind of eating itself from within, and the question is what's driving it. But I'm so pleased that you want to bring the Bill of Rights to the Soviet Union, and I think I finally figured out why. I think it bothers you that it is the liberal trade unions and the students and the liberals that are bringing down the Eastern Bloc countries and the Chinese. Does it trouble you that they're all people that you probably would be on the other side of that's challenging the system?
If the argument tonight is that the Democratic Party invented the Bill of Rights, I and James Madison repudiate that argument.
No, but we're very pleased that you're back.
Thank you. Steve, you're up. Mr. Solarz, please step to the podium and submit to an interrogation here. Who wants to start? Mr. Gingrich. You two have gone at each other in the House many times, I'm sure.
I'm curious because you are clearly a man of considerable knowledge about the world.
Stop there. Next question.
The topic is the Cold War is coming to an end or is not coming to an end. Now, it would seem to me that prudence would lead you to believe that you might say that the Cold War may be coming to an end and it may not, that only time will tell. Your colleague, Congresswoman Schroeder, said a while ago that she would not trust the Soviets to keep their word with their own citizens, but that she would apparently trust them to keep their word with us. How would you argue that it is irreversible in the context, say, of China and other events? And shouldn't the United States start from a position of very, very prudent caution, assuming that Gorbachev might not succeed?
Newt, nothing is irreversible. Change is the law of life. Over the course of history, there are democracies that have become dictatorships, and there are dictatorships that have become democracies. Even if the Soviet Union were to evolve in a more open and liberal direction, there is, of course, a possibility that it could revert to its more repressive policies of the past. But because change is the law of life, we have to deal with countries as they are and as they are evolving. And it seems to me it is very much in our interest to encourage a further evolution in the Soviet Union toward a more open, toward a more democratic society, in which their policy is characterized not by military expansionism, but by military retreat, not by ideological hostility, but by ideological irrelevance, not by an uncooperative diplomacy, but by a cooperative foreign policy, which is what is beginning to happen in the Soviet Union. And I think those changes, which are reversible, are all to the good.
Mr. Perle.
Congressman, surely you're right that there have been dictatorships that have given way to democracies, but can you cite even a single example of a communist totalitarian state that has given way to democracy?
I can cite two that would have given way to democracies, both Hungary and Czechoslovakia. If the Soviet Union had not intervened back in the 1960s militarily. But I think we now witness in Eastern Europe examples of communist countries that are beginning that process. In Poland, they just had the first quasi-free elections in over 40 years. In Hungary, they're talking about establishing a multi-party system. And unlike previous Soviet leaders who crushed democratic movements in Eastern Europe, Mr. Gorbachev appears to have given the green light to the leaders of Hungary and Poland to move toward democracy and a free economy.
There have even been some elections in the Soviet Union, and as you may recall, it was a two-step process. There was first an election in which some 500 or so individuals described as dissidents were elected, and then there was a winnowing out process in which they finally settled on the presidium, which was going to exercise real power. How many of the 500 or so dissidents wound up in the presidium?
I don't know the precise number, but what I do know—
One, Boris Yeltsin.
And what I do know is that in the recent elections for the Congress of People's Deputies, for the first time since the Bolshevik Revolution, they had multi-candidate secret ballot elections in which some of the top leaders of the Communist Party, members of the Politburo, were defeated even though no one was running against them. Well, I think this is clearly evidence of significant change. In the recent meeting of the Congress of People's Deputies, Richard, as you probably know, there were debates in which the KGB itself was denounced, in which some of the top Soviet leaders were criticized. And all of this was put on Soviet television. This didn't happen under Stalin. This didn't happen under Khrushchev. This didn't happen under Brezhnev. Has it gone far enough? Of course not. Does it need to go further? Of course it does. But have they gone a considerable difference from the repressive policies of the Stalinist era? Even you, I would submit, cannot deny that.
No, the no. issue. The issue is, as I tried to suggest earlier, is not whether there is change. There surely is change.
The question is,
come to our side of the table.
The question.
We'll welcome you with open arms, a man of your intellect.
What's at issue here?
Come on over.
What's at issue here, Steve, is.
You'll like it.
The leap of faith.
Try it. It'll be, you used to be with us
if,
before you went over to
if
the
I
other
wound
side.
Up.
You know, I remember when George McGovern said, come home, America, I say, come back, Richard.
I remember when George McGovern said the Cold War is coming to an end 20 years ago, before the developments that you now cite as indicating that it's coming to an end. But
well,
if I came over
just,
to your
it
side,
just shows you that,
Steve, I'd have to ignore.
Possible.
I'd have to ignore too many facts, and in particular, I would have to ignore the overarching fact that, despite Gorbachev, despite the indications we see of change, and we're hopeful that change will lead to the end of the Cold War, despite all of what we see, we also see the weapons coming off the production line at the highest rate we have ever observed.
Which is exactly why we need a conventional arms control agreement, which will bring that production
Thank
to an
you.
End and establish parity in Europe.
Thanks, Congressman. Mr. Perle, Senator Hart, come on up. And Mr. Perle. And you will now have 5 minutes to question each other, starting with a question from Mr. Perle to Senator Hart.
Senator, of the 441 SS-20 missiles that the Soviets have been obliged to dismantle under the treaty eliminating medium-range missiles, how many of those have been replaced by a longer range and more capable Soviet missile known as the SS-25?
Well, Mr. Perle, it's been quite some time since I've had access to classified documents or security information, such as I'm sure you still have access to, so I can't answer that question.
If I were to tell you that all of them have been or are being replaced, how would you then regard the treaty to which you and others pointed earlier as an indication that the Cold War is coming to an end?
Well, first of all, I didn't use those treaties as part of the evidence that the Cold War is beginning to come to an end. What I did indicate was that many students of Soviet affairs, including a very distinguished American, Ambassador Kennan, have concluded that our principal response to the Soviet Union should not be as a military opponent, but rather as another superpower with whom we ought to negotiate better terms. That is not euphoric and is not romantic.
Would you have considered that the Cold War was coming to an end under Mr. Brezhnev?
Well, Mr. Brezhnev served for quite some number of years, and as I recall, President Nixon felt during some of those years that we could certainly make better terms with the Soviets. And like President Reagan, who followed, came around to believe that security for this country was not in an unlimited nuclear arms
race. I don't want to answer that question. I only mentioned it in passing because it was Brezhnev to whom George Kennan was referring when he referred to the Soviet leader as a man of peace. In short, there are a great many people who have thought for a great many years that the Cold War was coming to an end, who now draw selectively on the evidence of the Gorbachev administration, but who, in doing so, ignore the point I wish to bring us back to, which is the absence of any significant change in the Soviet military program, despite the enormous burden on their economy of what they're doing.
If you're asking me a question, that's simply not true.
How to explain it?
Conventional forces are being unilaterally reduced in Europe, and contrary to an assertion Mr. Buckley made earlier about these being ancient old tanks, in fact, many of the tank divisions being withdrawn from Central Europe are frontline, top-of-the-line forces, and those are being withdrawn unilaterally.
They're being relocated. They're not being...
Well, they're being withdrawn from Eastern Europe.
That's correct. And at the same time, we see the Soviet production lines working at full capacity.
As ours are.
But could I suggest that there's a difference? The difference is...
Of course there's a difference. That's not the issue.
The difference is,
First of all, ours are not operating at anything like the level of Soviet production lines. But the essential difference is that it is not the United States that poses a threat to the Soviet Union. It is not the United States Army that is poised to invade the Warsaw Pact. The Soviet Union enjoys massive superiority in these conventional forces. Why do they need a treaty to reduce that massive superiority?
No one said they did. And in fact, Mr. Gorbachev has taken the position that he doesn't need a treaty.
But your colleagues, Senator McGovern and Congressman Solarz, have explained the high level of continuing Soviet military investment in terms of the absence of treaties between us. If their economy is burdened, as it is, by military spending, and if they have massive and unnecessary superiority,
and as ours is,
could we not expect the Soviets to make unilateral reductions in order to salvage their economy, knowing that there's no significant threat from us?
Senator, answer that question, then go on the offensive.
Under this leadership, yes. Under previous leaders, no. And that's why our side takes the position, as I think many Americans do, that there is a sea change in U.S.-Soviet relations in the Gorbachev years. And to neglect that change, or to pretend it doesn't exist, is to neglect reality. If we use as a standard for whether the Cold War continues or not, whether the Soviet Union has adopted all of the democratic guarantees of the United States, then of course the Cold War will never be over. My question to you is, do you want it to be over?
Of course I want it to be over. But I think we ought to define what we mean. It will not be over, in my judgment, Senator, until the Soviets cease this massive, unnecessary, and menacing investment in the further accumulation of military power. And what is striking about the changes we do observe in the Soviet Union, like the changes we observed in China, is that they are all reversible. Indeed, historically, they've been reversed in the past. The liberalization that we see today, we've seen in the past. The end of the jamming, it's not the first time they've ended the jamming. The reaching out to Western industry, it's not the first time they've reached out to Western industry. Most of the time, they're stealing our technology to put into their weapon systems.
Mr. Perle,
all of this can change overnight, and as long as that military power is there, we have to be concerned about the consequences of an abrupt change.
Of course. And no one on this side is arguing otherwise. But your side, you and your side, have accused us here tonight and those we represent of being euphoric and romantic, among other things. And my question is, how do you then account for the fact that that same euphoria and romanticism has swept up Margaret Thatcher, Mr. Kohl, and Ronald Reagan?
Well, I think it would require three separate explanations.
Do Reagan. I think that's the one we're most interested in.
Well, take her. That would be interesting.
But I don't think Mrs. Thatcher is in the least euphoric. She's certainly very clear about the necessity for maintaining Western strength. I think Helmut Kohl is driven by unhappy political circumstances in the Federal Republic to say things in public that at least I've not known him to say in private. And as for the president, I think President Reagan, I think he very much hopes, as I'm sure everyone on our side does, that we will, in due course, see behavior on the part of the Soviet Union that is consistent with the rhetoric.
But
until the deeds match the words, it's premature to declare that the Cold War is coming to an end.
But that is not what Mr. Reagan said. That is not what President Reagan said, former President Reagan said last week in England. He said that Mr. Gorbachev was a totally different leader than the Soviet Union had ever had, that fundamental changes were occurring there, and that we should respond to them. Now, is that euphoric and romantic?
No, that statement in itself is not euphoric, and it's not.
Well, I haven't heard anything different said on our side here this evening.
Well, I think what your side has been saying this evening is that indeed it is bound by the terms of this debate to defend the proposition that the Cold War is ending. And as long as we see a discontinuity between what the Soviets are doing and what they're saying, I think we have a right to insist on evidence that the behavior matches those deeds. I'm sorry to sound repetitive on that point, but everything that we have seen and heard having to do with internal reform in the Soviet Union, welcome though that is, has thus far failed to be reflected in their approach to military power, and that's what's so troubling. And if those who wish to encourage the end of the Cold War declare now that it is over, then we will be relinquishing the pressure on the Soviets to take those steps that could mean real stability and could mean a genuine relaxation. But those steps must come in the form of a reduction in their military investment.
Right.
Accept, if you will, briefly, the hypothesis that the Cold War is coming to an end and will end. What do you think should be the central organizing principle of this society beyond anti-communism?
Oh, I think this society stands for the thing that is doing the most definitive demolition job on a failing Soviet society. It has demonstrated that when people are given freedom and opportunity, they can achieve material well-being for their society. In the Soviet Union, where people were taught that you had to sacrifice individual freedom to get well-being, that doctrine is now dead. So we should carry on doing what we've been doing.
Thank you. Congressman Gingrich will now submit to questions from the left. Who wants to start? Congressman Solarz.
Newt, several years ago, you vocally and vigorously criticized several of us in the House of Representatives for sending a letter to Daniel Ortega in Nicaragua in which we encouraged him to hold free elections on the grounds that by corresponding with what you characterized as a communist dictator, we were usurping the president's constitutional prerogatives to make foreign policy. I happen to have a letter here, which was written on August 8, 1988, to Mr. Gorbachev, which I notice you and some of our other colleagues in the House have signed. I'm not quite sure why it's appropriate for you to write to the biggest communist dictator of them all, if it's inappropriate for some of us to write to a little communist dictator in Nicaragua. But leaving that aside, leaving that aside, this is my question. In the letter, you write, "Dear Mr. General Secretary, we are pleased that under your leadership, there have been some recent improvements in the area of human rights. Can you tell us what those improvements were that you were referring to?"
Without looking at that specific letter, I can't, because there have been a series of letters, many of them, as you know, on behalf of refuseniks, asking the Soviet Union to allow them to leave the country. And I have been very positive in my willingness to consistently support letters to the Soviet government asking them to allow people to emigrate. So I'm not sure which specific letter, but let me comment.
What are the improvements in human rights that you were praising Mr. Gorbachev for?
You raised two different questions, and I do think you put your finger on a central problem that the left has in America. There is a difference between writing to a Nicaraguan dictator during a period in which the American government is actively engaged in trying to undermine it, and writing to a Soviet leader during a period in which we are, in fact, trying to find a way to open up the society.
During a period in which the Cold War is coming to an end.
I think there is a difference. But let me come back to your point. No one on our side would in any sense suggest that we are witnessing anything less than an extraordinary period. Let me remind you. There have been a series of extraordinary periods in Soviet history. There have been in Russian history. There have been a series of moments of opening up. One could certainly have thought immediately after Khrushchev's secret speech on Stalin in 1956 that remarkable things were going to happen, and they almost did. There are a number of times that happens. I think if you look at the election results, in which it became 16 times more likely to be defeated if you're a Soviet provincial leader than if you're an American congressman, that is a remarkable change. I think there have been a lot of things going on in the Soviet Union. The question is, one, is it stable? And two, does the reality of domestic change necessarily mean the end of the Cold War? And all we're saying on our side is, A, we're not certain it's stable, and B, we are quite convinced that in and of itself, allowing Boris Yeltsin into the new Supreme Soviet hardly constitutes the end of the Cold War.
Ms. Schroeder.
I understand what you're saying, that things are evolving, and we're not quite sure where they're going to evolve, but we're glad you at least concede that point. Let me go to another one. At one time when we know they weren't evolving, in fact, they were deteriorating very rapidly in your history period, was when the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan. And you voted to lift the grain embargo, and you also voted against the McDonald Amendment to cut off trade. Now, I mean, that was clearly not a good time, and you had a Democratic president out doing things. What's your solution when the Soviet Union then veers back to its old expansionist thing?
Well, I think Pat, you put your finger on two very good examples of how to be effective and ineffective in foreign policy. I think that the grain embargo was dramatically successful in hurting Iowa farmers and relatively irrelevant in hurting the Soviet Empire. Secondly, I think, and I think, frankly, we have been very remiss in the last 18 months in this. I think that the correct way to drive the Soviets out of Afghanistan in terms of their own forces was to have given them stingers. I wish we'd given them stingers 4 or 5 years earlier. I think, and this is a fundamental disagreement about the reality of military power, I think when you're faced with a powerful dictatorship willing to use military force, no reasonable answer stops it except countervailing force.
So you would feed their people? And you would then proceed to trade with them so they got more technology?
No.
I mean, I don't get that at all.
I know you don't. That's one of the problems we have in these dialogues. standing here in the city, which deals in more grain trading than any other city in the world, let me try to briefly explain. The world grain market is open to anybody with resources to buy things. If we cut off American farmers, the Russians pay very marginally more for Argentine or Canadian or other wheat, but it costs more about communism.
I mean, let's lay it out there, right?
All right.
But it costs more to the U.S. than it does to the Soviets.
Thank you. Thank you, Congressman. Let's see, where are we? Senator McGovern. Please step up to the podium and submit to interrogation from the right. Mr. Buckley, we haven't heard from you for a while. Maybe you have a question for the senator.
I think General Haig. Yeah, I have a question for you, Senator. Your comments about arms control and the urgency of this matter seem to reflect a lack of sensitivity for the major steps that have been taken by the administration, and they seem to have a partisan overtone. Are you dissatisfied with the proposals Mr. Bush put forward for substantial conventional reductions, with the treaty that was achieved in the INF area, and with the outlines of the START agreement that are now under discussion?
I think, as a matter of fact, they're very positive steps. I was surprised to see some of your colleagues trying to prove that the INF agreement is falling apart. I defend Ronald Reagan on the INF. I think it was a good step forward. And frankly, I thought the Bush proposal of a week ago was a pretty good one on conventional arms. It obviously was weighted on the American side. He was proposing we take out 30,000 troops and the Russians take out 325,000. I stuck my neck out when I was asked about this by a reporter in Europe, where I'd been lecturing the last couple of weeks, and said I thought maybe Mr. Gorbachev might accept it anyway. He came to Bonn the next day and said it was a good proposal. Let me just read you the International Herald Tribune, just the first couple of lines here. Mikhail Gorbachev welcomed with satisfaction President George Bush's initiative.
Did you read the statement he made on the last day of his visit?
I didn't expect to get 100% endorsement. I don't think you did either. But in general, he said it was a positive step forward. That's about as good as you can expect.
Are you willing to stake your trust in Mr. Gorbachev that he's going to snap up this good deal?
I don't think he's going to snap up anything. I don't think he should. I don't think we should either. I think all of these things have to be looked at very carefully.
Senator, may I ask you this? What makes you confident that this exchange a month or so ago will actually realize the goals we have in common? For instance, we have 22,000 planes in NATO. The Soviet Union says we have 30,000. We have 17,328 artillery pieces in NATO. They say we have 57,060. We have 3,900 planes in NATO. They say we have 7,100. Mm-hmm. Now, given the fact that none of these engagements in disarmament has been effective, given the fact that they violated SALT I, as Senator Hart admitted here a couple of months ago, what on earth causes you to be optimistic that we can, in fact, realize a verifiable, meaningful disarmament with, that does not, in fact, jeopardize our deterrent force.
Bill, I think the Soviet Union acts as all great powers does. I say great in the sense of just being powerful, in that they're not going to agree to anything that isn't in their selfish interest. And I think that's what motivates us as well. I think that's why President Nixon negotiated the SALT I agreement. I don't regard him as a dupe or a fool because he negotiated that treaty. It was a step forward at the time. I think SALT II could have been also. I think the nuclear test ban was. These agreements have not all been failures.
Why do they need 53,000 tanks? Why do they need 48,000 artillery pieces?
I don't think
they do.
Why do
they need four aircraft carriers and 76 nuclear submarines? Who is threatening them that they need this? The whole logic of the wheel is to turn, and the logic of the Soviet armament is to aggress.
Yeah. I don't think they do need all that stuff any more than I think we need 13,000 nuclear weapons.
No, what we need is a function of what they have.
I think that each side has carried this thing to the point where it's absolutely ridiculous. You have two countries bankrupting
In the first place, we're not bankrupt. In the second place, we're rich. In the third place, we're spending 5.7% of our GNP, which is half of what your hero Jack Kennedy said we should be spending.
Well.
And in the fourth place, it wouldn't really matter if we had 10 times as many nuclear bombs, as long as we're not going to use them.
Is that a question?
They may be unsightly. But what does it matter how many we have, so long as we don't have aggressive intentions?
Well, if war should come, it makes a big difference how many are thrown
the
around.
The idea is for war not to come.
Let me say this to
that's
you, Bill. One thing that's troubled me about this discussion tonight, you and some of your colleagues have thrown this word pacifism around very loosely, even accusing the whole German nation of having gone over to pacifism. Let me say to you that I was a bomber pilot in World War II who flew 35 missions against the Germans. They weren't pacifists then. If they are today, I say hallelujah. I think that's a step
in the right direction. Thank you. Time is up. General. General Haig. General Haig, it's your turn. Now, here's an odd couple for you. Congressman Solarz and General Haig will question each other, starting with a question from General Haig to Congressman Solarz.
All right, Steve, baby.
It's supposed to be
I'm
a kinder and gentler
by
America.
Crossing the line. First, by making one observation that my side has made that I don't agree with. And that is that the reason Gorby has become a good boy is because we stood tall in Grenada. My God, we could have sent the Providence police force to Grenada. We better understand that, of course, it was important to build our strength, to stand in Afghanistan, to support freedom. But what really made Gorby a good boy was the total failure of the Soviet system in political, economic, ideological, demographic, and in security terms.
Do you disagree?
Now, I agree. And that's why I think the Cold War is coming to an end.
No. You see? That is a rhetorical response which shows that perhaps you are cuter than you are wise. What I would suggest is that the fallacious conclusion that because we were tough and we overbuilt our strength and we then Gorby became a good boy, now we don't need that strength. That's the conclusion, and that was what was wrong in the last campaign. Because today, those who are opposing the maintenance of our strength are doing it on the grounds that we don't need it any longer because Gorbachev is good. Now, the facts are we've won a victory of values. That involves political, economic, moral, ideological, and security aspects.
I agree.
Now, that I wanted to hear you say. I am so pleased to hear it. And I hope you agree that in order to keep the benefits flowing, that we hope to maintain those assets that have brought about these wonderful changes, the failure of Marxist-Leninism and the prevalence of Western democratic values.
I think, Al, we need to remain strong so long as the Soviet Union poses a threat to our society. But I hope you would agree that one element of national strength can be mutual and beneficial and verifiable arms reduction agreements. And if we can achieve such agreements at the strategic and conventional level with the Soviet Union, they can, in fact, enhance our security at a lower level of arms than either side now maintains.
Well, I would certainly hope so.
I'm going to get fired if you guys keep agreeing like this.
Because we collude secretly.
Yeah.
Now, am I still on?
You're
supposed to ask me questions during this period, Al.
I think I did. Now, on the Ortega elections, I must say, I'm not quite sure why you wrote that letter. Maybe you could explain it.
Then you can answer it and then go start answering questions.
We wrote the letter in order to encourage Mr. Ortega to have genuinely free and fair elections in Nicaragua so that the people of Nicaragua could freely and fairly determine their own destiny.
Now ask a question.
And your prognosis?
No, now you've got to stop. Go ahead, ask a question.
Well, let me ask you.
I agree. On that point, I agree with William James. I'm neither an optimist nor a pessimist, but a possibilist. Al, I'd like to ask you this question. Do you think there is any change between the Soviet Union under Stalin and the Soviet Union under Gorbachev today? And if so, what are the changes that you believe have taken place?
Well, I think there are many changes that have taken place. Some are environmental changes, explosion in communications, which have made it more difficult to conduct police state tactics. The interdependence that's developing between all the nations in the world. The emergence of multipolarity rather than just superpower domination. All of these things are historic evolutionary changes.
Under Stalin, the Soviet Union eliminated the kulaks as a class, induced a famine in the Ukraine, had the purge trials and the show trials. Millions of people were executed and sent to jail. Is that taking place in the Soviet Union today?
No, it is not. But there are still very many repressive and unacceptable Soviet policies which clash with the fundamental values that you and I espouse. Now, that doesn't mean that we are going to isolate ourselves from the Soviet Union, that we should not encourage additional change. But we should be very much aware that Mr. Gorbachev could indeed be an endangered species. I saw Mr. Cheney was criticized for saying that recently. He's absolutely right. I don't know a single Soviet expert who doesn't say he's an endangered species.
Let me tell you, Al, that there are some people who think that Mr. Gorbachev may be around longer than Mr. Gingrich. But I have one other question I'd like to ask you. You were commander-in-chief of NATO, and during those years, I was privileged to meet with you.
Oh, those great days.
And I heard you say on many occasions that because of the conventional imbalance in arms in Europe, if a war broke out, it might be a matter of weeks at the most before the Soviet Union and its Warsaw Pact allies were in a position to overrun Europe.
I think my successor used to say that.
Unless we went nuclear. Now the Soviets have put an arms reduction proposal on the table. And I'd like to ask you, if we can reach an agreement, as President Bush has suggested, in the next year with the Soviet Union, in which they agree to major asymmetrical reductions, going to parity in tanks, artillery pieces, armored personnel carriers, and aircraft, in which both NATO and the Warsaw Pact have exactly the same amount of armaments, rather than the situation we have now where the Soviet Union and its Warsaw Pact allies have much more than we and NATO do. Under those circumstances, would you consider the security of our European allies to have been significantly enhanced and a major step taken toward the end of the Cold War?
Yes or no?
I would like to see such an outcome, but I would have to see a number of other issues related to that premise satisfied. Verifiability, not unnerving and this conglomerating West Germany.
But if it happened, you'd consider it significant.
Mm-hmm. We're out of time. Thank you very much. Here's another odd couple. Who goes first? I guess you, Mr. Buckley.
What if we agree, like the last one, huh?
Then I'm out of a job, I'm afraid.
Mrs. Schroeder, did you read the newspapers yesterday?
I move my lips when I read. I'm very slow.
Well, there was a meeting of 600 economists in the Soviet Union, presided over by Leonard Abalkin, who is the deputy prime minister appointed to that position by Mr. Gorbachev. And here's what he said. Our studies clearly show that if the economy is not stabilized over the next 1.5 to 2 years, and the start of the improvement is not achieved, a rightward swing by society is inevitable. Now, we know what rightward swing means in Soviet terminology. It means in the direction of Stalin, not necessarily reaching Stalin any more than we would reach heaven by going heavenward. But here is the right-hand man of Gorbachev saying in 18 months, a change is inevitable unless they solve the economic crisis.
Is that a question?
My question is, what are you going to do 18 months from now if they do take this swing toward the right, which is being predicted not by us, but by the right-hand man of Gorbachev?
First of all, I'm glad you listened to economists. I'm not so sure even in our country I would listen to them for political advice. But
Mrs.
let me say,
Schroeder, don't be coy.
All right, I won't be coy. Okay. Let me answer your question. I think an awful lot of people, in fact, including me, feels that Gorbachev sees Soviet power as being military power and feels that that military power cannot be sustainable unless he closes the gap.
What's
internally
that got to do with my question?
And domestically between,
Mr. Chairman,
this is the economist.
Make her answer my question.
What can I do?
This is the economist.
I said, what does he propose to do if the prediction is realized that's made by Gorbachev's right-hand man?
Okay, because
and all of a sudden we're talking
about
something or other.
If he doesn't close the gap between the civilian and domestic and military economy, he feels that he cannot sustain his military power, which I would think
I said,
to be happy that I said
that. What are you going to propose? Right now you're saying the Cold War is on its way to being ended, but the right-hand man of Gorbachev says, unless there's a transformation in the Soviet economy in 18 months, it's all over.
Well, then now, I think we ought to move very hard to take advantage of the 18 months and get everything we can get.
So what do you want to do? Well, should we send them? Well, no, we can't send them any goods because that would ruin George McGovern's worry over the deficit.
Well, we ought to get.
We can't bail them out.
We ought to get every kind of agreement we can possibly get that is verifiable, and I insist on verifiability.
I'm not talking about disarmament now. I'm talking about this crisis. Now, Vladimir Tikhonov.
Do you want us to convey?
I'm asking you questions which you are declining to answer. Said that famine is there in the very near future. Unless farmers own the land and decide for themselves what to grow, there will be no increase in production. If that is correct, then doesn't that fortify the judgment of the deputy prime minister that the crisis in the Soviet Union, for which I have seen no preparations here, is one with which you are unprepared to contend?
No, because Newt's going to feed him anyway. I mean, he fed him before, he'll feed him again. He's going to turn this grain market here in Chicago loose and feed him no matter what. But in all seriousness, let's look. The second law of thermodynamics says you can't push anything faster than you're not moving yourself. And I am troubled in that the United States is not out there with a broader vision.
We're not out there with a broader vision
in order to move the Soviet Union where we want them to go in 18 months.
Mrs. Schroeder, our wheat production is going to be low this year, but we're really in no problem at all. We're not going to disrupt our constitutional process within 18 months. Incidentally, you must hear Viktor Belkin. He got up and said, in economist, sometimes I wonder if we can survive through the autumn. The economy is becoming increasingly cannibalistic, feeding on itself. And finally, another economist said, and what is being done by the Gorbachev government
It is simply acting like an alcoholic in charge of a liquor shop by simply inflating the currency.
Mr. Schroeder, you don't have to answer that
here
non-question.
We have, from
just
the heart of the
question.
Soviet Union, predicting that the situation which is appeasing you all isn't going to last for 18 months.
Let me ask you something. What happens if it doesn't collapse in 18 months? I mean, why are we not preparing, and why are we not taking advantage of this opportunity to get any arms control agreements that might be negotiable?
What do you mean?
If he runs
we're
away
not taking
from
advantage
them, then
of
we've
it.
Smoked them out
we're
as a
We're meeting
phony.
In Vienna in September to have a nonstop 24-hour day business on this disarmament.
Right.
What do you mean, not taking opportunities?
I think everybody in the world feels that we could have been much more aggressive in
well,
taking
do
those
I count as a member of this world? Because I don't think so at all.
And I think, okay, everybody except Bill Buckley feels that we, look, Don't forget what JFK said, and I think it's very important.
He
always said that you should never negotiate from fear, but you should never fear to negotiate. And I think that we ought to move to negotiate as fast as we can.
Sorensen
well, let me ask you a question.
Did that right up through
Chappaquiddick. Why does your good friend, one of your great heroes, one of your great heroes, Ronald Reagan, want to give SDI to the Soviet Union if all of this is going
to
happen?
Well, now, because we want to absolutely guarantee that it won't be misconstrued as an instrument for an aggressive
You guys are crazy. Newt wants to feed him. You know, Ronald Reagan wants to give him SDI. What is going on?
Wait a minute. He is prepared to continue to sell grain to the Soviet Union, which we are doing.
Uh-huh.
But what are they going to... How are they going to pay for it? Maybe they charge it to the West Germans. Maybe they borrow from our S&L.
Well, they gave them credit. They gave them credit.
So, the point is,
I mean, you know, you got to look at this.
You simply declined to comment on a crisis which we cannot affect.
That's right.
We
so what
that
would
crisis.
You like to do? Would you like to have us invade
They are
in
living
months?
Through the legacy of 70 years of Soviet communism. We won the Cold War the first day it was declared in the sense in which you people are talking about, because we're right and they're wrong. But I'm saying we can't bail them out of their crisis, but what we are doing is permitting the fragmentation of the Western alliance as a result of their maneuvering while we just sit here and gloat.
You must agree that the vision of the Marshall Plan cemented those teetering Western European countries and literally eradicated indigenous communist parties there. And I think that's something we should
be
very proud of.
You must be cuckoo. The Marshall Plan was begun in 1949.
And at that time?
In 1948 and 1950, the second largest Communist Party in the world was in Italy. The strength of the Communist Party in France was 25% up until six years ago.
And it's taken...
It required gulag before they de-gutted the enthusiasm of the communists
happened,
among the intellectuals.
As all of this has happened, you have to admit that it's really moved and nobody's worried
I'm
about
very
an
much
indigenous
in favor of
Communist
the Marshall
Party
plan,
in the...
But it didn't
Western
eliminate
Europe.
The internal communist threat in Europe.
Yes, I think it certainly put it to rest as you solidified it, and I think what we should be doing is doing everything we can to solidify the economies of Eastern Europe.
What can
so
we do?
More
I'm
democracies
what we can
bloom.
Do. You keep talking about making
I said we ought to
disarming
be,
more rapidly, but
no.
Short of
only
doing,
if they're verifiable. I think we ought to be talking about getting all of their troops out of Eastern Europe. They will survive.
We can't get them to comply with the terms of SALT I, which is 27 years old.
Well, if they don't comply, then we've smoked
and
them out.
We've just,
but if we don't
Haig
negotiate,
just, and Vic Perle has just shown you that they have already made up whatever they lost in the INF treaty.
I have this feeling you will both ask the question and answer the question. And you will not,
no.
The gentleman will never yield for 1 minute.
I think on that.
The gentleman will not be a gentleman.
I know that you don't answer the questions because you can't.
No.
All right.
I am answering the question, but you yell over me.
This is all getting a bit ad hominem. Thank you very much. Thank you, Vest. You're all through. Well, you're not through. But... You'll be either glad or distraught to learn that the time has come for closing arguments. And closing for the negative position is Senator George McGovern.
Since General Haig has entered a mild dissent to one of his colleagues, let me just say for myself on the question of selling grain to the Soviet Union, I take the same position as the late Senator Humphrey, who once said, I would sell the Russians anything they can eat, chew, wear, and can't shoot back. I think my I think my former colleagues in the Congress, Congressman Schroeder, Congressman Solarz, Senator Hart, and Congressman Gingrich will agree with me that very few speeches in the Congress ever changed a vote. But one of the exceptions to that was the closing speech on the limited nuclear test ban treaty in 1963 given by the late Everett Dirksen of this state. Senator Dirksen told us that on the previous night, he had reread John Hersey's moving account of the bombing of Hiroshima, including a word picture of a young family sitting at their breakfast table, charred black from radioactive fallout, dishes, books, and furniture littering the house, a little doll, a broken tricycle. And he said, someday they're going to bury me out at Pekin, Illinois, and when they do, I don't want people to say he knew about this, but he did nothing. Now, today, 26 years later, we have an opportunity, I think, with a new type of leadership in the Soviet Union, and I hope a constructive leadership in our own country, to take another move towards survival, towards an end to the arms race. We're not talking about weakening America, we're talking about strengthening America against the debilitating effects of this 40-year arms race. For 40 years, we have said, all these years, that we want a Soviet government that is more reasonable and peaceful. Now we have such a Russian leadership. It seems eager to get out from under the burden of armaments, not to please us, but to serve their own self-interest, even as it serves our interest. This Soviet leadership, as we've seen here tonight, has made a number of rather dramatic moves that indicates that there is a fundamental change in their approach to the world. Mr. Gorbachev says to us, let us recognize our real differences, which we're aware of, our ideological and political differences, and the differences in our social and economic systems, and then let those two systems compete peacefully for influence and power in the world. I think the time has come for us to say once again that we know about these realities that face us around the world, and let us not have future generations say we knew about it, but we did nothing.
Thank you, Senator. Mr. Buckley.
On the 2nd of November, 1988, there was an official commemoration of the 70th anniversary of the Bolshevik Revolution. Mr. Gorbachev, the hero of our team over here, made the following statement. In October 1917, we parted with the old world, rejecting it once and for all. We are moving toward a new world, the world of communism. We shall never turn off that road. Which Gorbachev are we supposed to believe? The one who coaxes 93% of the German people to idolize him? Caspar Weinberger, when accosted on this program recently with the fact that he admitted to $70 billion rubles in defense, he said, well, that's four times more than the Soviet Union has ever confessed to before, and half as much as they actually spend. When are they going to get around to recognizing the Covenant on Human Rights, which they endorsed in 1973, or the Helsinki Treaty that they endorsed in 1975, or for that matter, live up to the Treaty of 1972? Is it not true that the Cold War is precisely as it was described by Mrs. Kirkpatrick? Can we say that Latvia, Estonia, Lithuania, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Bulgaria, and East Germany think that the Cold War is actually coming to an end? Where have they experienced this freedom which defines the conditions of that Cold War? The fact of the matter is, we can't decide whether Gorbachev means it when he's talking to the Soviet Union, whether he means it when he's talking to the West German idolaters, when he's talking to
Fidel Castro while feeding and continuing to feed those revolutions. The fact of the matter is the Cold War is not coming to an end. There is change, there's always change. There's change in our own constitution. But my own feeling about it was confirmed subjectively when just 1 week ago I renewed my subscription to the only political committee I belong to. It's called the Pearl Harbor Committee to keep one's eyes on the Russian fleet.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Well, if I may summarize the conclusions of the study group, I'm sure we all agree on everything now. It seems to me that the panelists actually agree on two things and disagree on two things. They all agree, number one, that there are remarkable changes going on in the communist world, especially the Soviet Union, and they agree, number two, that these changes are not going to lead to a Soviet system that looks like the United States. What they disagree on are also two things. Number one, how far these changes are going and whether they are reversible. And number two, where exactly you draw the line to define the point at which the struggle between America and the Soviet Union looks like the Cold War. And on those two things, I think we're just going to have to agree to disagree because we're out of time. We will be back in September with a debate on economic policy. And meanwhile, I'd like to thank the panelists and thank the audience on behalf of Firing Line. Good night.
This Firing Line special was made possible by a major grant from Farley Industries, building worldwide leadership for America. Additional support was provided by the Chicago Resource Center, Incorporated, and the Chicago Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SICA and Producers Incorporated, who are responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this Firing Line special, send $5 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. William F. Buckley, Jr. offers 20 years of Firing Line guests from the 60s to the 80s. For $19.95, you can receive this companion book by calling 1-800-872-8642. Credit cards are acceptable.